the material basis of Mauryan Empire. Say for any empire, it is very essential that they should have some material. Apart from precious metal, money, what is the material source for this empire? Excavations are carried out, and ultimately, we are having very good idea that metals are the material base of this empire, and farming, the agricultural products, they are very important. As we have discussed, Magar, which is having here plateau of Chota Nagpur. So, mines are very much important from Magad point of view or from empire point of view. We are having use of iron. Various equipments are found. No doubt that various equipment, they are having low category of iron. The evidences are showing that even common people, they are carrying out iron material. No doubt how to produce high quality or good quality of iron, that was known for these people, but that was carried out at higher level. The local level, they are using ordinary instruments which are having considerable low quality of iron. Anyway, but this mining industry was the backbone for this empire. And apart from that, the agriculture. In order to increase crops, new villages are also carried out. People are transferred from overpopulated area to less populated areas. They are deported from overpopulated areas, and new settlements are carried out. They are called as Sita land. And the new villages are constructed. Certain cities or certain villages, they are not in use, they are again made in use. So like that, Mauryan Empire was giving more efforts on construction and say development of villages, in order that the agricultural use and agricultural revenue should increase to a greatest extent. And therefore, the first part, the material source for any nation, as we are discussing, for any state, any nation, this is important. So this is the material source for Mauryan. The economy was depending upon the material obtained from the nation, especially minerals, then the revenue collected from agriculture, and what is the more important, that trading with Central Asia, Western world, as well as Eastern world, because the empire was having somewhat, say here, is all territory that was under Mauryan Empire. And therefore trading was much important in this Mauryan Empire. Now, as we have discussed, that certain taxes were there, the economy was encouraged, but still the social problems were there in this Mauryan Empire. Say for example, class system was prominent, as we have discussed, even in judiciary system also, that was not for equal of all. Different class-wise punishments were there. This is Brahmanism, what the historians say. This religion as Brahmanism rather than Hinduism, they are saying. The Brahman and Kshatriya were considered as upper class. Third class, that was Vaishya. Vaishya was engaged in trading. They can gather as much as money, and they were very rich because trade was going on very well. So Vaishya community was very rich in Mauryan Empire. But they were not having political rights. No doubt, whatever the richness is there, but political right were not there for them. Then Shudra, they were not having any political right during them. And so these two communities were not satisfied. And therefore, certain religions. So for example, today also, if you just observe that maximum traders, they are belonging from Jain sect. What is the reason? In old days only, they might have transferred from Vaishya to Jainism. This is also possible. Then Buddhist or Buddhism was also accepted. The reason that these sects, say Buddhism or Jainism, spread over the empire, the most probable reason that the Shudra and Vaishya, they were not having any political powers and somewhat inferior positions in practice of different deities were also carried out during Mauryan period. It was different from Vedic period. So for example, worship of idol, that was also carried out. Lord Shiva, that was worshipped during this Mauryan empire. Then Lakshmi, the goddess of fertility, usually historian call this as non-Aryan deity. So that was also worshipped during Mauryan rule. Several temples are constructed with idols. That means idolatry was more popular during Mauryan rule. And the society was going well, but this type of problems were there because certain rights, they are given on terms of birth. That means suppose a person is having birth in the house of Vaishya, that means he is Vaishya, then he can earn money as much, but he should not get any political power. So this was the problem during Mauryan Empire. In order to summarize this empire, we are now carrying out just summary, whatever we have discussed, that we have to summarize. First thing, we have to give all credit to Chandragupta Maurya and Chanakya for constructing this huge empire. See, already Magad Empire was very vast. That vastness was extended by Chandragupta and Chanakya. And in the recorded history, the first vast empire from eastern part to western part, that was carried out by Chandragupta Maurya. So first success of Chandragupta Maurya is constructing huge empire. But only constructing huge empire is not important. In Muslim rule, say for example, Alauddin Khilji, Muhammad Tughlaq and Aurangzeb, these three emperors, they were able to construct such a huge empire. But Alauddin's empire was not stable. From different part, whatever he was going to conquer, from different part, again and again rebellion was there. That same case was observed by Muhammad Tughlaq, and ultimately at death of Muhammad Tughlaq, the empire broke out into different provinces. Same way in case of Alauddin Khilji, the empire became disturbed at death of Alauddin Khilji. And ultimately, certain disasters are carried out. We'll discuss that part later. And in Aurangzeb's empire, why we have to consider Aurangzeb's empire? Because Aurangzeb constructed huge empire as Ashok. From Kabul, Kandahar to almost all the South India until Assam, entire India was under control of Aurangzeb. But it was lacked in proper administrative system. So during his rule only, empire start breaking up. The different provinces they conquered, again and again we have to conquer, that Aurangzeb has to conquer this province, and the control was not efficient one. And ultimately at death of Aurangzeb, in few years, this vast empire collapsed up. No doubt, just for name, this empire was continued till 1857. But the practically speaking, the zenith point or glorious point that was there in rule of Aurangzeb only. Later on, the Mughal empires were not having that much power. But this is not the case in case of Chandragupta. Alexander, just take example we have discussed just now, that Alexander was able to construct huge empire. But at death of Alexander, that empire splits up into different parts. The thing is that the construction of empire is different, and
maintaining of this empire, huge empire, that is different. So we have to give credit for Chandragupta, and most important to Chanakya, that Chandragupta was having power of sword. He was able to construct huge empire, but with proper administration. And we have to more concern over now administration, as you are going for civil services. You must learn these all techniques, whatever given. And no doubt, I must say, the lectures are not only sufficient. We can give guidelines. In 500 hours, we are not able to cover entire thing. So your own reading is important. When we are discussing this history part, I am giving you certain books. You must go through these books. Say, for example, R.C. Muzumdar's books are very much important in order to study out this. Then, as we have discussed, the another book and various textbooks available for this course, you can refer out. Notes are there, but notes are not always perfect and not able to cover entire thing. You must read in detail the facts. And so, what is my suggestion over here? That you start your own reading. Different books are available. You can go through these different books, especially from ancient India, medieval India, different parts are there of history, as we have discussed earlier. So this we have to discuss, we have to study out in detail. Okay, now let us concentrate once again and summarize this topic. The Mauryan Empire was extended at its maximum area under rule of Emperor Ashoka. What is the Mauryan policy that was based on Arthashastra? That emperor is considered as supreme. He was also considered as Dharmadhyaksha. That means the religious power was also concentrated in hands of emperor. The important thing is that even the religious and political matter, the political matter was considered as supreme. The emperor was considered as supreme with all respect. The empire was having different provinces, and usually the Kumar, that means prince, was in charge, which was guided by Maha Amatya, council and Amatya. Even emperor was guided by council, and according to Arthashastra, the emperor should have council that should have maximum number of members, ministers. The reason is that that will ensure good administration. Now, the different departments were working, and departmentalized work, that is characteristic of this Mauryan Empire. Then different levels of administrations were there, that province level, district, that means Pradesh level, then Gram, that means village level. So like that, different levels are there, and power is given to particular authority. The independent power is important, because at that time communication systems or transport system was not much there. For execution of work, the powers, the required powers were handed over to these persons. Then, as we have discussed, that Nyaya Vyavastha, that means legal arrangement was there, the courts were there, then different courts were there, the different level of courts, they were also set up there. Revenue system was properly maintained, and ultimately, whatever the work, public work, that is important, that is carried out. Of course, this all things are carried out on behalf of huge army support. Later on, this empire, so this is the glorious part, glorious epoch of Indian Empire. The world's best administered empire was there, but after Emperor Ashoka, this empire came to end in just 50 years. Surprise, because as we have discussed earlier, that empire was in very good condition, very well administered, and surprisingly, this empire came to end in just 50 years after Ashoka. The reasons are so many reasons we can give. Number one, the first economical reason we have to discuss over here, that continuous famine was the problem for this empire. So that will disturb, that is going to disturb your economy. The revenue system was affected because of this. The second thing, that empires are built up and maintained when strong army is there. We are able to defeat Greeks and we send them out of Indian boundaries. But beyond Indian boundaries, Greeks were there. And because of exception of Buddhism, and one of the most important principle of Buddhism, that is non-violence. Because of that non-violence, India was at that time faced various problems. So for example, the constant attacks of Bactrian Greeks and Parthian Greeks were carried out from this northwest frontier. That means we have to think of longer period. We should not think only in history. We should not focus on particular part. We should think of longer period. So we are able to defeat out Greeks, but just by signing one treaty and making them dive away from Indian society, it is not sufficient. Today also, just observe, in this particular region, still today, various problems are going on. And what is the important thing? That we should consider these problems. We should find out the answer. Because whenever problems are in his path, later on these problems enter the India. Say for example, Alexander. He was wandering all over in this region first. If whatever carried out by Chandragupta and Chanakya, if any other person was able to carry out in earlier days, then it might have possible that Alexander is defeated on border only. But this is not the history. Whatever has happened, that we have to find out. So ultimately, this Ashoka's empire, rather we should say Maurya empire, was came to end as Brihadrath Maurya was the last ruler of this Maurya dynasty. He was executed by his general named Pushyamitra Shunga. After death of Ashoka, Greek emperor, there is again question that one should call as Greek or not. The reason is that Alexander's invasion was there around 326 BC. And now we are discussing the period that is somewhere around 185 BC. So after hundreds of years, these Greeks were ruling over this part, that is Seleucid Empire, the empire which belonged to Seleucus Nicator, that is called as Seleucid Empire. So the Seleucid Empire was here, and the Bactrian king, if you are aware, now this is rough map of Afghanistan, and the part of this Afghanistan here, that is on the border of Iran and northwest side of Afghanistan, that was called as Bactria in old days. Actually, Sanskrit name, that was Baldhik. Even in Mahabharat, again and again, references of these Baldhik people, they are there. So Sanskrit name, that was Baldhik. It was abbreviated, or say it was somewhat corrupted as Bulk. And in Greek, they are called as Bactria. The Greek settlements in this region, the Greeks are called as now Bactrian Greeks. By race, they were Greeks, but they were settled out in this area for a long period. So many times they are referred as only Bactrians, supposed to be referred as Bactrian Greeks. Then this Bactrian Greek king, Demetrius, he carried out attack over India. Demetrius entered from this area and landed over this Takshashila region first. Surprised to know, not defended. Because we lost our fighting power. As during Alexander's reign, Alexander's period, the problem was there. Alexander suffered a tremendous opposition from Indians. But here Demetrius was able to enter over here. Alexander was thinking of crossing river Indus. Then he afraid to cross Bias River, which was there in Punjab region only. But the Demetrius, I'm just changing out the pen here. The Demetrius was able to pass out here. And obvious thing, when emperor is not there in empire, certain problems are happen to be there. The Bactria, some problem was there, and this Demetrius was not now in Bactria. So some revelation was there, and he lost the kingdom of Bactria. No problem, India is there for everybody. He sat down in this portion of India. Then he marched from this, he crossed over that Bias River also. The vast Mauryan Empire, but he was able to penetrate here, and ultimately he was able to reach till Ayodhya. Surprised to know, enemy when crossed out Hindu Kush mountain range, then all area is plain. One can carry out huge battles only with help of rivers, because rivers are in this area, they are dominant. Important protection can be provided by rivers only. If we are able to cross out river and ultimately Ganga, Yamuna, etc., then the plains are there. And ultimately Demetrius was able to reach till Ayodhya. But very good thing is that the king from this Orissa region, here we can get Orissa region, the name of Emperor Kharvel, the Kalinga Emperor Kharvel, was able to fight out with this Demetrius. Tremendous fight was carried out between Demetrius, that means Greek, Bactrian Greek, and this Kharvel, the Jain ruler of Kalinga, Jain Emperor of Kalinga. He was able to fight with this Bactrian Greek, and ultimately Greeks were defeated and just sent back. But now keep in mind, our border, we are not considering this. Set back means what? Till river Indus. Surprised to know, we lost our territory, and ultimately we were calling till river Indus, that is India, means from east to west, till west boundary we are considered ourselves as river Indus. Beyond Indus there is Yavanasthan. Yavanasthan means place of Yavan. The Greek people, they were able to settle over there. We lost this territory just because we were not having strong military power. We lost our military power, and therefore this Greek Empire expanded in India till Ayodhya. But this is not the case. History repeats. Alexander, all right. Demetrius, all right. Menandrus or Menander, the next ruler, Greek ruler, invaded India just after 4 years. And he was also able to come till Ayodhya. But when he entered in Ayodhya, he stopped out his propagation for a while. The reason, whatever mistake carried out by Demetrius, that should not be repeated. We have to make hold over India first, and then conquest should be carried out. So Demetrius was unsuccessful because he was just go on marching in India. So Menander just take halt at Ayodhya only. Then there was a debate between Nagasen, a Buddhist monk, and Menander. The debate was carried out, and ultimately after 3 days Menander was defeated in the debate. Nagasena asked him to accept Buddhism, and Menander was converted to Buddhism. Whatever the question and answers are carried out between Menander and Nagasena, that was recorded, and book is there, that is called as Milinda Prashna, Sanskrit, or Pali language Milinda Panna, English questions asked by Milind. So all this book, all of these questions are recorded in book. Now the name suggests this is Milinda Prashna or Milinda Panna. Who is the Milind? The Menander. After accepting Buddhism, the name is also changed. Instead of Menander, he was termed as Milindus. Also accepted Buddhism, and they worked for Buddhism they stayed over here. But in Pataliputra, some different issue was carried out. Ruler of Maurya dynasty was Brihadrath Maurya. He was killed by his general, the name Pushyamitra Shunga. He was a non-Buddhist. Brihadrath Maurya was Buddhist, obviously, because Ashoka was Buddhist and henceforth they carried out work for Buddhism. So he was killed, and ultimately, again, the Brahmanism or Vedic religion came in the privilege. Now this Pushyamitra Shunga was ablest general. He accepted the throne and then he marched towards this Minander. The fight was there from Ayodhya, and ultimately the Minander was defeated till River Indus. So this way history repeats. The second invasion of this Greek, that was also carried out and routed in same way. But what is difference? The first Alexander, he was not able to cross out these rivers. Say he was still only river Bias. But the second phase, begins with this Bactrian Greek. The first attack carried out by Demetrius, second by Minander. Both the invaders are able to reach till Ayodhya. That means by even crossing the heart of India, they crossed till this portion. Ultimately, no doubt they get defeated over there. But the thing is that we lost our certain territory in this battle, because henceforth we consider the river Indus or river Sindhu as our boundary line. Till here, there is India or Aryavarta. Beyond Indus, it was Yavanasthan. Yavana means Greek. We simply donated, lost out that territory for Greeks. And Greek settlements were carried out in this region during that period. Say, in case of Chandragupta Maurya, we are considering the Hindu Kush. Name was not Hindu Kush at that time. Name was Pariyatra Mountain. So we were considering Pariyatra Mountain as our boundary line. But now we are considering River Indus as our boundary line. So this is the impact of Greek attack. The second phase of Greek attack, that is Bactrian Greek and Parthian Greeks. Now Pushyamitra Shunga carried out horse sacrifice. In Sanskrit that is called as Ashwamedha Yajna. So he carried out horse sacrifice. His son Agnimitra, name is also very nice, Agnimitra. So his son Agnimitra was there with horse. Simple thing is that we have to release out horse, allow that horse to run freely during the period of 1 year or so. And wherever that horse enters, if the king is opposing that, then we have to carry out battle, fight with that king and ask him to surrender, or simply defeat him and annex that kingdom for you. Like that. And if you want to challenge, anybody wants to challenge, they can conquer that horse and challenge. If you are defeated, then you are having no right to carry out Ashwamedha sacrifice, that is horse sacrifice. And so this thing was carried out, and obviously the Yavanas means these Greeks, conquered this horse. The Agnimitra was so powerful that battle was fought between these Yavanas and Agnimitra, and ultimately Agnimitra was able to rescue that horse from Yavan. So this battle was carried out in Yavanasthan. What is that Yavanasthan? Beyond Indus. So in that region only the war was fought. Then the South India and Deccan, actually we are calling the Vindhya line. But the South India is having some different culture, and Deccan, actually word is Dakshin, Sanskrit word is Dakshin, reformed as Dakkhan. In English we are calling that Dakkhan as Deccan. So this portion is called as Deccan, whereas this portion is called as South India. So South India and Deccan,
that was now not part of Mauryan Empire. In Deccan, the another dynasty was ruling over there, that is called as Satavahana dynasty, or that is also called as Andhra. Now, there is always doubt, okay, wherever we are discussing this, we are going to discuss in detail. So let us just check out that the princess of Vidarbha, Vidarbha is this part of Maharashtra. So this part, the central province, it was belonged to central province in British rule. So that is called as Vidarbha. No doubt, entire Maharashtra was not part of Aryavarta. But Vidarbha was part of Aryavarta from prolonged period. You are aware that wife of Sri Krishna, if you are telling that as history, then wife of Sri Krishna was there from this region, Rukmini. She was of Vidarbha. Then if you are aware of story Nala Damayanti, then Damayanti was princess of Vidarbha. The same way, the Malavika, the princess of Vidarbha, she married out with Agnimitra, the son of Pushyamitra, prince of this Shunga dynasty. And the story is nicely described by great poet, that is Mahakavi Kalidas. The Sanskrit book that is referring all this story, the name is Malavika Agnimitram. Malavika Agnimitram. So this story is there. That famous book is present on this incident. So this is about Malavika and Agnimitra. Now Shunga dynasty ruled over another 100 years. And it is written in Buddhist literature that Buddhist people were troubled because of this Pushyamitra Shunga. He was against Buddhist. Like that, evidences are given in Buddhist literature. But we have to think twice, thrice. Say for example, whether he was against or against betrayer of the nation. Say for example, not all, but certain Buddhist people, they were in the favor of Minander. Why? Because Minander accepted Buddhism. So immediately they get attracted towards this Minander. They were not thinking in this way that, okay, whatsoever matter, the religion-wise, Minander is Buddhist, but racially, he was Greek. And the Greek person is ruling over our nation, but the Buddhist philosophy is somewhat different. They were not considering the border of nation at that time. Entire world, with that sense, they were right, but from nationalist point, this was not right thing. And so, maybe possible, this is also reason that those Buddhists, they were pro-Minander, they can be persecuted by, or they can be troubled by this Pushyamitra Shunga. Whatever the true or the fact, that is not known. But according to this Buddhist literature, it is given that whenever king is not Buddhist, then he is going to trouble. Many times they are saying that, even next example, we are discussing that they are saying this way, that Buddhist, non-Buddhist kings, they are troubling out this. So we have to discuss this India, but before that, we have to discuss some of the world incident. As in basic lectures, we have discussed in just a few words, we discussed there. Now we have to go with detail. We have to take account of one nation over here, that is Mongolia. Why we have to take in account? Because henceforth, the world history is tremendously impacted with this Mongolia. A single nation can carry out this type of things. The world can be shaken. This way, we are going to discuss. First, we are going to discuss some about Mongolia. The north part of China, this Mongolia is actually northern Chinese part. Some northern China is now actually, it is in northern China, but it is actually Mongolia. And beyond the border of China, that towards north side, there is a nation that is Mongolia. Mongolia is not having any opening towards sea. It is inland. Towards north side of Mongolia, again Russia is there. Nowadays it is Russia.
then the land is obviously not having any seashore. The result is that it is having lack of rainfall. Considerable rainfall is not there. Comparatively cold weather. And a cold desert is present over there. We are naming that desert as desert of Gobi. But in Mongol language, Gobi means desert. So actually we are calling desert of desert. But anyway, we can keep in mind the desert of Gobi that was present, that is present in Mongolia. So land was not fertile. But in the history point, we'll find that many times the population of this Mongolia increases beyond a certain limit. And then obviously by law of nature, the migration can start. Now initially they were having neighbors as Chinese only. So the continuous war between Mongolia and China was going on. And if you are finding out in old days, hardly nation you can get find that there is no war between two kingdoms. Hardly any nation will find that if persons are there, the human settlements are there, then there is war between two neighbors. This is predominantly observed from time to time. Few exceptions are always there. So there was war, continuous war between Mongolia and China for several years. These Mongols were having nomadic habits, wandering here and there. Obviously, as we are saying today, that education is compulsory when a boy or a girl attends year of 2-3 years. Immediately we are going for playgroup, nursery, then junior KG, senior KG, etc. So education starts as early as possible from 2.5 year onwards, the education starts. In Mongol, same way, the education, but that is not of our education, horse riding, then war technique, as early as possible. And therefore, the Mongols were of very great warrior clan. They were very good in archery also. Obviously, in order to live, they had to carry out this type of work. Then they were very cruel. The cruelty is the most important here because they were able to threaten the part of world which they were going to conquer. And so they accepted that cruelty. The war techniques were like that, do or die. So this type of war techniques they were practicing. The horse riding, that was important for them. Usually, some foreign authors are saying, they were consuming semi-cooked food. What is the meaning of semi-cooked food? They are explaining that we have to keep flesh on horse and then sit over it and carry out ride wherever you want to do. And ultimately, whenever you are finishing out your ride, whatever the cooked flesh is there, because there is friction between horse, flesh and person sitting on it, so that much heat is sufficient and they were consuming that food only. According to certain books, these people were fond of, the Chinese people decided to protect their nation from continuous attack of these Mongols. And they constructed a huge wall, that is the Great Chinese Wall. That means the fear or threat given by a Mongol was at that time so great that Chinese people were forced to construct this type of protection, the fortification. Huge wall was constructed over the border. And keep in mind that this is the only object which is observed from moon. The man-made object on earth, no other man-made object is easily observed from moon. But this Chinese wall is observed. So this is the threat of these Mongol people, or Hun. They were termed as Hun in earlier days. So Mongol or Hun, the cruelty and threat was so high that this type of wall, which is visible from moon, that was constructed over here. Now, this wall was not able to protect China perfectly, but it was obstacle for Hun that or Mongol people to enter in Chinese territory as per their desire. With help of war, these Chinese people can able to fight with this Hun, and therefore Hun decided to shift over the territory. Now in those days, as we have discussed earlier, the world was in nomadic form. Settled world was very less, otherwise it was nomadic form. Now in history, the role of Mongol is very important because they carried out certain shifts of the population, destruction of definite empires also. Mongols are appearing again and again in history periodically. Say for example, in old days also, we are having threat of Mongol. Certain evidences are there that Mongols were entering in India in old days also. Simple evidence, whatever the skeleton obtained in Mohenjo-daro, that was two skeletons of Mongol we are able to obtain there. That means Mongols were entering in those days also. Then the second important thing, that many times these people were termed in different way. Say for example, the Indian terminology many times that is not a perfect one. Say for example, Yavan. This word is used for Greeks in old days. Then when Islamic invasion was carried out, then these Islamic invaders, they were also called as Yavan. So this is mixing of two concepts by single word. We have to discuss like this, that whenever the reference we have to check out. Say if you are having some references 600 AD before that, then you have to consider that Yavan, that means Greeks or outsider. Actually we are confused, or our ancestors, they are confused by using such type of word Mlencho. Mlencho is another word used again and again, that is a Sanskrit word. The meaning of Mlencho is the tribal people or nomadic tribes coming from Central Asia. So this is Afghanistan. The beyond Afghanistan, whatever the territory, we are calling that as Central Asia. The non-Aryan people, again racial, no, non-Aryan means what? Not well civilized. So non-Aryan invaders coming out from Central Asia, they were termed as Mlencho. The Greeks were termed as Yavan. But ultimately, even great personalities in India like Varahamihir, he was also confused. According to him, Yavano him Lenchasteshu, that means Yavan and Mlencho.